On the phone, we have Nick Soulsby, the author of I Found My Friends, The Oral History of Nirvana. And right now, you are in Spain, good sir. This is exciting.
Good morning to you guys over in Oregon. That's the thing I think of Oregon as exciting, whilst you think of Spain as exciting. It's all about what you don't get to see often.
Oh, man. Well, I can assure you, you're missing nothing but the rain. Now, speaking of the rain, this, of course, is a very exciting interview. This book, I Found My Friends, just came out today. It's it basically tells the story of Nirvana, one of the biggest bands in rock and probably one of the biggest bands in the Northwest here. And it tells the story in kind of an interesting way, basically through the people that knew Kurt Cobain and the band and the people that worked with them, right?
Correct. I mean, basically, I think I've got 40, maybe even 50 Nirvana books on the shelf, and you see the same people being interviewed again and again. You know, does Dave Grohl ever go into an interview where people don't ask him about Nirvana? So I got very interested in all the what I'd call the normal people, the guys like you and I who go out, do a job, who have a passion for something, who wanted to play music in their spare time, and who, by sheer chance, end up on stage with Nirvana at some point, often just looking at them as just another band. And I think that's what inspired me, is getting back to this idea of these guys as just people with a passion, trying to get heard, trying to do their thing, and then something really strange happens. And it just seemed a new way to tell an old tale, and also one that might spread a bit of respect around an awful lot of people who were putting an awful lot into their music.
And it's a very interesting book. I'm reading it currently, and it's fascinating because me being in the Northwest and kind of growing up during that period, a lot of the bands that you interview are pretty underground bands. Some of them, you know, the mainstream might not have ever heard of, but I know a lot of these bands, and it's crazy to hear their stories, you know, in the early days, especially going into, you know, before Nirvana got big, you know, hearing these crazy, you know, just regular dude stories. It's kind of cool.
That's it. The early days are fascinating. Just this band who get up on stage, do their thing, and no one's heard of them. They just treat them as guys from the neighborhood, as people they can walk up and meet. I met a guy in Tacoma called John Perkey, who is in about half a dozen bands back then. But he, you know, to this day, he still has cassette tapes that Kurt Cobain's handwritten to him, containing the early demos, containing the first drafts of Bleach. He's got a copy of the Love Buzz single with a big note on the front from Kurt, sarcastic about, you know, this is our first single. Guess you might like it. It isn't even our song. It's really curious to get back to the days when these guys are kind of not exactly rich. I think you could say that.
Yeah.
One story that didn't go in the book was someone told me that they were in Olympia, and this is as late as 1991. And they bump into Kurt walking down the street. He's tossing his apple up and down. And the guy said, Kurt, with the apple. And Kurt said, oh, I haven't eaten in 3 days. I'm saving this for when I'm really hungry. And all the guy thought was, when you're really hungry?
Wow.
It's really funny to get back to that era where they were just an underground band, where success might have meant a few tens of thousands of records maybe, but no more.
And it's really crazy because, you know, looking back, you kind of forget how quick the ride really was for Nirvana. I mean, between the time they started and the time of Kurt Cobain's death, I mean, it was only a few years, really. And it's crazy how fast it all happened.
That's it. It's a rocket ship. There's a whole section where I didn't really have to ask people how surprised they were. They just kept contributing stories about walking into petrol stations and suddenly seeing their friends on every single magazine cover, or turning the radio on and up comes Smells Like Teen Spirit again and again and again. The guy's from Sun City Girls. I mean, he's working in an office. They've got the TV on in the lobby all day with the sound off. And he kept walking through seeing this video. And it was only having seen it maybe 4 or 5 times, he realized he recognized the guy on screen. And as you say, the majority of Nirvana's story happens before they're famous.
Yeah.
It's really strange. The moment they become famous, they retreat from the public. They stop performing as much. It's quite amazing how little there is left of the Nirvana story once they actually become known.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's also interesting now in 2015. You know, there seems to be a lot of stuff coming out about Nirvana. There's that new documentary coming out, Montage of Heck. The interest in Kurt Cobain has never really waned, but lately it's been pretty big. Was this something that you kind of saw coming, or did it just happen? You just happened to be at the right place at the right time writing this book?
I've certainly been very lucky. I think I'd say that. I essentially had started a blog. I'd been writing for a couple of years about Nirvana, and I didn't have anything left in me in terms of writing anything more about the band other than these little blog posts. Then back about, I guess it's 2 years ago now, I wrote a blog piece trying to summarize supported Nirvana. That led me to think, I wonder who these guys are. Exactly what you said. Who are all these little bands from the Northwest? I was fascinated. The momentum just built. I started trying to find people. People were so friendly about it and so willing to share their time and their memories that eventually I think I just felt that I had to complete the work. And I felt I owed so many people for being so courteous and so pleasant. Essentially, the publisher said it should come out March next year. I said, okay. And by sheer coincidence, there's this film release going on in the background. So I guess I feel a little blessed on that front.
Absolutely. Now, one of the things that I'm curious about, of course, the Nirvana legacy is pretty tightly controlled by his widow, Courtney Love, who a lot of people not a big fan of necessarily. But did you have any contact with her? Or is this considered an official release? Did you get green lit from Courtney to get these stories published? Or how did all that work?
Fairly easy. Essentially, you are allowed to write what you wish. I mean, you accept that you might end up in court if you said something appalling. But a friend of mine managed to relay copies of the book to Chris and to Dave. Meanwhile, the remaining drummers, we're talking people like Aaron Burkhart, Dave Foster, they took part in the book, Chad Channing, friends. So I got to the point where I was comfortable with what I'd done, was respectful of something that I have a passion or something that I genuinely love and have done for well over half my life. That felt pretty good. I guess the creepiest thing was, I know a lady in Australia who is a professional astrologer. That's her job. She interviewed Kurt Cobain in about 1992, and she walked into a hotel room when she arrived in London. She just walked into a room one day, and she says she walked in, and what she heard was the opening chords of Smells Like Teen Spirit coming straight through the window. And it turned out the guy in the room next door had a guitar out and simply proceeded to ham his way through the entire album. So to someone in the astrology trade, she took that as a bit of a sign that maybe it was worth at least meeting with me and seeing if I was a complete fool or not. Luckily, it turned out maybe I'm not. Let's see.
In my opinion, that's synchronicity.
There was a lot of that. People who, just nice moments. There was a lady I spoke to down in Texas who performed with Nirvana in 1993. She got on the phone. She told me about how she'd had quite a lot of medical trouble recently. We had an excellent conversation. When she got off the phone, about 2 weeks later, I got an email saying that just a talk about her past had left her feeling so energized and so positive about it that she immediately went and started to prepare work for her next album. I spoke to Kurt Danielson of TAD, and again, same kind of story. He came back and he thanked me for listening to him, when to me, it's me thanking him for giving me his time. And again, people would come back and say thank you for things, or would share some positive that for them had come out of the experience. And when I visited the Northwest, again, just numerous people who gave me a bit of their time and were willing to show me around. I like the Northwest. I think the friendliest people I've ever met. You make the British look so rude.
Well, we try. It's the rain, I think. It is a pretty amazing book because, again, you know, I was in high school during the Nirvana days. I graduated in 1995, so I was right in the middle of high school during, and Nirvana was really the band that made me want to be a musician, and here I am working in the music industry at a rock station, you know, 20 something years later. And you know, to read some of the stuff that you have in the book, it's awesome, because a lot of those bands, you know, they rolled through Eugene, Oregon down here, and you know, I caught their sets, you know, I got a chance to see those bands. I never got to see Nirvana, but you know, that time period was such a hotbed of creativity, and it because of all the insane amounts of creativity and different kind of music and bands that were happening, and just the breaking of the mold of what could be done. You know, we went from like the 80s with all this, you know, hair metal and, you know, very traditional styles, and everything was the same, and then, you know, it wasn't just Nirvana, it was a lot of the bands from the 90s that no one even remembers that changed everything. And, you know, it's great to read their stories and go, oh, I remember that band, I saw Hitting Birth, oh man, you know, stuff like that is really cool.
That's it. I admire stories like, I mean, like yours. I mean, people who, it didn't matter what they did, but they were seized by a passion for a scene, they were willing to make them part of it, whether that meant they became DJs, whether they ran record labels, magazines, fanzines, played music themselves. The number of roles that people ended up taking up in that scene is what I really adored, the idea that they did create something from the ground up. People were telling me that punk bands couldn't get gigs very easily, that gigs for under 21s were very rare. But all those groups, for the people who were of that age, they built every single part of that scene. And that's really inspiring. It doesn't matter whether they became nobly known superstars or remained local. On each level, people are putting in so much energy that it created this, I think it creates the kind of groundwork that allows an alternative band to rise to the top. I mean, by 1991, Nirvana are almost late. You know, the Minutemen have had an album out on a major label, Dinosaur Jr. on a major label, Sonic Youth. There's so many bands that are already there. It's prepared all the work for suddenly someone to go the whole hog and make the perfect mainstream alternative rock album. And Nirvana, they do it. And calling that, never mind, a commercial album, I don't think it's an insult. I think they knew what they were doing. They wanted to see how far they could go, and they did it. And they did a wonderful job of it. So I think that was the crowning glory of an awful lot of work from an awful lot of people. I wish it was motivated at, you know, age 15, 16, 17, 20. Instead, it's taken me till I'm 35.
Well, it's never too late, first of all, and you know,
exactly.
That's kind of the most amazing thing about this story is how inspiring their story is to a lot of these people, and you know, the people involved. I mean, again, I wouldn't be doing what I do. I wouldn't have played music. I've been in bands all my life, and I'll be in bands later on down the road. And Nirvana was really the catalyst for me. You know, I listened to everything from Anthrax to Public Enemy to NWA to Slayer before Nirvana, but I never thought I'd be in a band until Nirvana, because it was like, wait a minute, that guy's just powering through some simple little chords. I just learned those chords. Holy crap, I can write a song too. And I think a whole generation of kids thought that same thing. And ever since then, we've seen, you know, perhaps the most prolific amount of music from that point to now than ever in history. And I generally attribute it to Nirvana in that era of music, because, you know, it showed the powers that be that, you know, you just needed a few chords and the truth and you can make it work.
Nice. I think that's a really good final line on it. In the book, Nirvana have a first manager, a guy called Ryan Agner, who essentially drags them to their first show. They've practiced for 6 months and they're still not willing to perform in public. So he sets it all up, gets all the equipment in the band, drags them all the way down to the gig and makes them do it. But he needs help in another way. He wants Kurt to help him learn to play, learn to write music. And all Kurt says to him eventually, so Ryan shows him little things he's done, and Kurt says, Ryan, no, those are songs. All you need to do, get some friends together, play those over, and that will make something. You've already got it. And that seems to be the kind of basics of it, that if you just start it, it's amazing where it comes to. I never imagined that I'd be writing about something I loved when I was 13, 14, when I'm 35.
Yeah.
I started back in 2012. There was a publisher contest or something. I thought I'd give it a go, just as a personal challenge. Yeah, a few years later, still writing about something on the door, which I guess if you start things off, it's amazing what happens next.